This week on Maker Update, promoting pawns, your life in pixels, a one-button microwave, and weeding out the bad wires. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome back to another Maker Update where we'll show you some cool new projects makers are making. I hope you're doing well. I've got a fun show for you, so let's get started with the project of the week. With over 1.8 million views in just a week, chances are you've already seen this video by Works by Design, showing how he made a 3D printed chess pawn that automatically transforms into a queen when it reaches the end of the board. You can find a link to the video in the description just in case the algorithm hasn't already fed it to you, but either way, let's take a minute here to geek out on this because it's not just about honoring the project. If you're watching this show, you're probably also interested in understanding and integrating these techniques. So how do you make the smallest piece on the board turn into one of the largest, using a purely mechanical, non-motorized design? What's more, how do you make the transformation automatic, not something you have to fiddle with or manually adjust? At this scale, it feels a lot like clockwork design, and in fact, in one of the early designs he shows, he actually used a clock spring mechanism to store and release tension. And I don't know about you, but the tiny ship-in-a-bottle precision of clockwork engineering is intimidating stuff, and enough to scare me away from a project like this. But on review, when you really look at the final design, the mechanisms he's playing with here really have more in common with a compact umbrella or a Nerf gun. You have a compression spring down the middle to store and release energy vertically, and then you have a combination of a lead screw and cams, which pushes some elements out horizontally at the top and bottom to provide some extra width. This cam mechanism, to me, reminds me a little of the element you'd see in an old camera iris. As it turns in one direction, pins that connect to the exterior panels are guided along a path moving out from the center, expanding those panels outward. When turned the opposite way, the panels retract back in. But the real breakthrough here for making it all automatic is this design for a magnetic trigger mechanism on the bottom of the piece. By latching the spring release to this compact, flexible trigger, all you need to do is pair it with a chessboard where the back rank on each side is magnetic. Instructions and files for recreating this 3D printed design are available on the Works by Design Patreon page for a small fee. If you're a chess player, or if you know someone who is, this could make a great project or a gift. Creatively speaking, though, I think this also invites us to consider where a design solution like this could be applied to other things. Maybe a pop-up table that can shrink down out of the way? Pop-up toys or models? A pop-up table lamp, maybe? If you have an idea, let me know down in the comments. More projects. If you're one of those people who needs a deadline to stay motivated, then I have the project for you. On Instructables from Rabbit Creek, it's an animated desktop lamp that provides a soothing graphical representation of how much longer you probably have left to live. Yeah, it's a little dark to think about, but there's something pretty nice about the way your vitality bar is displayed here. It's definitely not as panic-inducing as a countdown timer. It's also designed not to be up in your face with your impending death all the time. In standby mode, the LED matrix panels swivel to face each other and just provide some mood lighting. But at an interval you can define in the code, the panels gently swing open on servo arms and run through an animation that updates daily. The animation fills up to show a total lifetime of approximately 90 years, and then moves on to indicate on the bottom of each bar how many months you have left based on the birthday you provide in the code. In this case, each pixel, I believe, represents a month. Now, the appeal of something like this is really going to come down to one's own comfort level around their mortality. For the right person, I think it's an idea that could be very grounding and motivating to have as part of a daily reflection. One insight you may have is that life is too short to deal with the complicated buttons on your microwave. On YouTube, Reed Bigham shows how he was able to take a standard microwave and with an Arduino, reduce all its functions down to work just the way he wanted. And it turns out that what he wanted was a one-button microwave. Pop in the food, close the door, and press the only button on the panel to start the microwave and add 30 seconds to the timer. To cook longer, just keep tapping the button until you reach the cook time you want. Now, does that make this an objectively better microwave for the world? Of course not. but it's a better solution for Reed, and it's a great demonstration of the power we have as makers to rein in consumer product feature creep and customize technology on our terms. You can find a link to Reed's video down in the description. Now for some tips and tools over on makeityourself.org. The maker known as Node has a free PDF book you can download that is filled with over 1,000 useful DIY projects he's compiled from other makers over the years. The projects are organized into sections from furniture to gaming, music to gardening. There are tons of ideas in here to get inspired by, each linked out to the creator's project page. There's a useful new board from Adafruit that caught my eye. It's called the Pixel Shifter. It's around $5 and it's meant to work as a kind of Swiss Army board for interfacing between microcontrollers and different flavors of LED strip. The board does logic level shifting from 3 volts to 5 volts, which can be critical for getting some LEDs to play nice with the 3.3 volt logic pins found on ESP32, Pi Pico, or Raspberry Pi. There are screw terminals for easily making and unmaking connections. It also features an inverted data signal line for working with TM1814 type LEDs. Seems like a useful board to have around, even just for debugging problems with your LED projects. Another problem that may be plaguing your projects are poorly made jumper wires. On his channel, Matthias Fondel shows how he discovered that many of the alligator clip leads he's been buying recently haven't been made with the copper wire he was expecting. Instead, it turned out that many of the wires were using thin, copper-coated strands of iron wire bundled together. These types of wires work well enough to go unnoticed, but they can introduce some measurable and unintentional resistance into your projects. The good news is that there's a pretty easy way to weed these out of your collection. As Matthias points out, you can simply place a magnet on the wire and see if it sticks. Iron-based wires will stick, whereas copper wires shouldn't. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, check out Becky Stern's latest video, Arduino for Artists. You'll learn about Arduino's roots as a tool for artistic creative expression. You'll also get to see some inspiring examples of kinetic and interactive art based on Arduino. And of course, Becky includes some great resources for beginners who might otherwise be intimidated by a more engineering-minded approach to learning Arduino. Check it out. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Big thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible. Thanks to TMDC Workshop in Barcelona. And thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.